By the end of this video, you are going to clearly understand what are the federal regulations in the United States about electric bikes, and also have a basic knowledge about the laws in your own state. Hey everybody, welcome back to another video from Bolton E-Bikes. Make sure to hit that subscribe button. One of the common questions I get is about e-bike laws. Where can you ride electric bikes? What do the different classes mean? Class 1, Class 2, Class 3? What's a moped? Do I need to register it? Do I need to insure it? I have a clipboard with several pages of documentation and laws to make sure that I don't say anything incorrectly in this video. I can't really talk about all 50 states, otherwise this video would be ridiculously long. But what I am gonna cover are the laws in California specifically, one, because that's where I'm located, and two, because California was one of the first few states to adopt the three different classes of electric bikes, and that is the growing trend for most states. Now there are some rebels like Alaska where e-bikes aren't addressed, at least to my knowledge, in the law anywhere at all yet. So is that a good thing, bad thing? I guess that's up to the local law enforcement what they decide to do. Let's start with the federal laws because that's what supersedes the state law and that's what matters before anything else. In the United States, something like this is now known as a low-speed electric bicycle. I think the term low speed gives us an idea that these are not meant to be speed demons and go crazy. And I gotta take a moment to just turn around and see the background noise because that is awesome. Back to where we were. A low speed electric bicycle, it means it is a two or three wheeled vehicle with fully operable pedals. That means it has to have pedals according to federal law now, and an electric motor of less than 750 watts. Now, many of you know, this is a very popular motor right here. It's the 750 watt Bafang. It even says 750 kind of in the part number there. If we really want to follow the federal laws, we should probably say 749 watts, but I don't think anybody's going to be that picky because 750 watts is 1.01 horsepower, or one horsepower should limit things to 745.7 watts. But again, who's counting? It says the maximum speed on a paved level surface when powered solely by the motor. So in other words, if you are not using the pedals here, you are only using the motor, just using your throttle. They even get more specific. If you are 170 pounds, so let's read this again. This is ridiculous in my opinion. Less than 750 watts, maximum speed on a paved level surface when powered solely by the motor, ridden by an operator who weighs 170 pounds is less than 20 miles an hour. That's federal law. Nobody I know of is doing it that way. They're setting a program speed limit of 20 miles an hour. So effectively it's like a governor. You hit 20 miles an hour and the power cuts off. Now there is one real big benefit to the federal law in my opinion. A low speed electric bicycle, which is what we've been talking about, shall not be considered a motor vehicle. As long as it meets those definitions by federal law, the state level cannot classify that as a motor vehicle. It has a speed limit on that sticker that says 28 miles an hour, but according to federal law, it has to be less than 20 miles an hour. So how is this possible? Well, if you recall, the federal law says that when solely powered by the motor, the speed limit is less than 20 miles an hour. That means that if you are pedaling, you can go faster. There's sort of an arbitrary number, but I think I know where it comes from. And at the end of this video, I'm gonna go into mopeds just a little bit because I think that relates to this 28 mile an hour speed limit. So there's three different classes of e-bikes and only one of them is allowed to go faster than 20 miles an hour, and that's a class 3. But we're jumping ahead if we go there first. Let's first talk about a class 1 electric bike. Again, keep in mind this is in California and any other state that has adopted similar class 1, 2, 3 laws. A class 1 bike is a bicycle equipped with a motor that provides assistance only when the rider is pedaling. So that means a throttle, for example, this is a half twist throttle. Sometimes there's a full twist throttle, more like a motorcycle. Sometimes you have a thumb throttle on one side or the other. But effectively, any device that allows the bike to operate when you're not pedaling, physically moving the pedals, is not allowed on a class 1. The law clearly states that the motor provides assistance only when the rider is pedaling. In my mind, there's no gray area right there at all. And then it also says it ceases to provide assistance when the bicycle reaches a speed of 20 miles per hour. So as soon as you hit 20, the motor is going to cut off. That's a class 1. Now, one of the things that I see people get confused about is the wattage of an electric bike and the class. I want to make it clear that in the law, there is no differing factor at all in the United States and in most states that have adopted the different classes. Class 1, 2, 3, doesn't matter. All of them say 750 watts or less. Now, if we jump to a class 2, we have the same 20 mile an hour speed limit. However, a class 2 is a bicycle equipped with a motor that may be used to exclusively propel the bicycle. In other words, you don't actually have to pedal on a class 2 if you don't want to. It's not required. Now, that's why a class 2 bike can get away with having a throttle. And a class 2, by my understanding of the law, is the only bike that is allowed to have a throttle. Class 1, definitely not allowed. Class 3, I think there's some manufacturers that kind of read into a little bit of a gray area. The more I read the law, the more there isn't a gray area, but I'm going to tell you what it is, what it says, and what I think they're trying to do. A class 3 bicycle is a bicycle equipped with a motor. Once again, we've got a bicycle with a motor, less than 750 watts, and it provides assistance only when the rider is pedaling and ceases to provide assistance when the bicycle reaches a speed of 28 miles per hour. And one more thing in here, and equipped with a speedometer. Who knew? Now, this is where the Revy Bikes Cheetah and some others, let's say the Cheetah's cheating a little bit, because I showed you guys that it has a throttle. But take a look at the class sticker that's on this bike. It has a class 3 sticker. And they're not the only ones that are doing this. I've seen Juiced Bikes do it along with some others. And the way they're programmed is such that the throttle, if you try and use it by itself, it will get you up to 20 miles an hour. But if you try and go faster than 20 miles an hour, the throttle won't go any faster. But as soon as you start pedaling, then the bike will enable you to go to 28 miles an hour. To me, this is just a misunderstanding of the law. Basically, they tried to skirt around the class 2 and 3 requirements. It's kind of a hybrid between the two, but on paper, that shouldn't really exist. A class 3, according to this, is not supposed to have any sort of way to provide assistance unless you are pedaling. This bike can do that. I don't think that's quite the right method, but that's what's happening. So just be aware that that is a common method that manufacturers are shipping bikes. I don't think it's quite right. I think this should just be labeled as a class 2. Once again, class 1, you have to be pedaling 20 miles an hour. Class 2, also 20 miles an hour, but you don't have to pedal, so you can have a throttle. That's a plus in my opinion. Class 3, you have to pedal, but you can go a little faster, 28 miles per hour. Local government ordinances are allowed to permit or ban any class of electric bicycles on dedicated bicycle paths and trails. Class 1 and 2 are permitted, and class 3 is banned by default. So that means technically if I put a class 3 sticker on this bike, by default, this is banned on local bike paths and trails, unless the trails or the local municipality says otherwise. I think that's an overlooked point that most people don't realize, is that a 1 and 2 should be allowed by default, and a 3 is banned by default unless they have signs saying otherwise. Now, of course, on public roads, on California roadways, a class 3 can go everywhere. It's effectively a bicycle at that point. Now, what if you modify this bike in some way or another bike that effectively changes the class? Can you do that? Well, yes, actually you can. In 2016, that's when California introduced the laws for the different classes of electric bikes. And in January of 2017, a new law, or a new part of the law, was put into place that says that manufacturers or distributors are supposed to put a label on the bike. And there's a few things that are required on that label. Let me read the law to you. The label shall contain the classification number, makes sense, top assisted speed, and motor wattage of the electric bicycle, and shall be printed in Arial font of at least 9-point type. So I've had some people complain about the size of the stickers that I've created and I sell on my website for changing the class of your e-bike. Well, there it is right there. I have to put certain things on there, and I have to make it at least a certain font size, and I even have to use a specific font. Very particular about that. The one thing that doesn't make sense to me is why they require the motor wattage. It seems like it should just say less than 750 watts, because whether it's a 250, 350, 500 really doesn't matter, at least in the United States. Are you allowed to change it? Well, it clearly says, should a user tamper with or modify an electric bicycle, changing the speed capability, they must replace the label indicating the classification. So not only does it allow for it, but if you have, for example, on this bike, a class 3 label, if I want to remove this throttle and make it so I have to pedal it, limit the bike to 20 miles an hour, at that point, I am supposed to put a new class 1 sticker on the bike. That's why I do have those class stickers on my website, because I'm all about modifying, changing things the way you want to, and that's one of those things that I just couldn't find on the market. So you can find those at boltonebikes.com if you either don't have one on your bike at all, or if you need a different one. Jumping back to the federal law, it says that the bikes can go 20 miles an hour motor only. That's perfectly fine by federal law. You don't have to be pedaling. That's a state law that says that you have to pedal. But what the states then did to get more speed, basically, out of an e-bike, is say that if you are pedaling, then you can go up to 28 miles an hour. Now, it's somewhat of an arbitrary number, 28 miles an hour. So in my mind, I think, hey, there's hope for this, actually, because that means on a state level, they could in the future possibly modify the laws and create another class that has an even higher speed and is still not a motor vehicle. Instead of 28 miles an hour, could have said, if you're pedaling, you can go 40 miles an hour. I don't think that's gonna happen. And the reason I say that is because in California, if you go to more power and 30 miles an hour, now we get to something called a moped. I really think the only reason that the California law went to 28 was so there was a clear distinction between a bicycle and a moped. Otherwise, a bicycle and a moped could go the same speeds or overlapping, and it might be a little bit confusing between the two. What is a moped? And I'm bringing this up for two reasons. One is so you know what is the next step above an e-bike, because I have people that ask me all the time, what if my bike goes faster than 28 miles an hour? What if it goes 35 or 40? Can I register it as a motorcycle? And the answer is no, you can't actually, because then it has to have a VIN. Basically, it becomes a motor vehicle at that point, and it's just not possible to do that. At least in California, that would be extremely difficult to take something like a bicycle and register it as a motor vehicle. Then you'd have to have a yearly registration fees, you'd have to have insurance, you'd have to have DOT approved lights and turn signals. It gets very, very complicated very fast. Now, a moped is kind of in the middle there. That's because a moped actually has a plate and it does have a registration, but it's not as complicated as a motorcycle as a car. For a motorcycle, for example, you have to register it every year. A moped doesn't have to go through that same process. To get a plate for a moped, you actually mail in a form. I actually did this just recently with something I have in the shop. Maybe I'll show it to you later if this test is successful, because I registered something that's very unique and is definitely not a motor vehicle, hoping that I can get a moped plate for it. Effectively, you send in a one-time fee. I think it's $22 or $23 in California right now. It's mailed in. No one ever sees the bicycle, the moped. They don't know what it is, what it looks like, other than what you put on the single one-page form. And effectively, they mail you back a plate, which you put on your bike, and it stays there forever. It's good for life. You never have to register it again. There are more requirements for riding a moped on the road. In California, you're supposed to wear a motorcycle helmet, and you're also supposed to have a motorcycle license. I don't think too many people are aware of that. You gotta have it registered with a small plate. You gotta wear a motorcycle helmet, and you're supposed to have a motorcycle license. Now, on the plus side, it's totally road legal at that point. You can drive it on the road. As long as you can go fast enough, that's the downside to a moped. It's limited to just 30 miles per hour, so you don't get a whole lot more being in the moped category. And there are some more requirements on things like turn signals and brake lights, things that are handy on electric bicycles, but not required by law. There is also a maximum limit on the power for a moped, and that is 4 horsepower, which comes out to about 3,000 watts. So if you want something where you don't have to pedal, because on a moped in California, it's not required to have pedals if it's electric. That's one of those weird laws I don't understand. If it's gas, you have to have pedals, but if it's electric, you don't. Whatever. You can go 30 miles an hour, you don't even have to pedal the thing at all. It doesn't even have to have working pedals if it's electric in the state of California. And 3,000 watts is a decent amount of power. So something like the X15 bike that we have listed on our website, if you tuned it down to 3,000 watts, now you're getting close to that moped territory where you could get a plate and make something like that possibly street legal. Finally, the last difference between these different classes of electric bikes would be the helmet laws. So in California, if you are 17 and under, then a helmet is required. Doesn't matter what class of e-bike it is, you have to have a helmet on. A class 1, 2, or 3 electric bike, of course, that's gonna be a bicycle helmet. A moped, then you have to get registration and a license and everything and wear a motorcycle helmet. So big difference there. Now, a class 3 electric bike in California does have a helmet law. So that's something to be aware of, that you could possibly be ticketed. I haven't heard of anyone having this happen, but if you are riding a class 2 e-bike with your friend and he's riding a class 3, you both don't have helmets on, technically the person on the class 3 could get a ticket for not wearing a helmet, the person on the class 2 wouldn't. I hope that simplified the laws for you and this makes a whole lot more sense. The main thing you need to remember though is to just go have fun. Get on your e-bike, go for a ride. If you don't have one, of course, make sure to hit that subscribe button. Subscribe to Bolton E-Bikes. And if you need a bike, go check out boltonebikes.com.